Welcome to International Securities Exchange's podcast series. Facilitated by renowned educators, ISE podcasts are intended to teach beginning as well as seasoned investors the ins and outs of trading. To find an updated list of podcasts, please visit www.ise.com/podcasts. Please be sure to listen to our important message following this episode regarding the risks of investing in exchange-traded options.
All right, it is 4:30 p.m. here in New York, so we're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome to this afternoon's webinar. Today's session will be hosted by Jason Ayers, who will be teaching us about technical signals for FX options strategy selection. And for those of you who are wondering, this webinar recording will be available on ISE.com later. You can just check out ISE.com/archives in the next couple of days if you'd like to check it out. So without further ado, Jason Ayers is president and founder of OptionSource.net, providing education and opportunities in the stock and options market for over 5 years. OptionSource.net is one of Canada's leading educators in trading stocks, options, futures, forex, and commodities. So we're going to go ahead and turn it over to Jason now for this afternoon's session.
All right, great. Thanks very much. Of course. It's just a quick sound check to make sure that everybody can, in fact, hear me before I get moving forward. So, Katrina, could I get a confirmation from you that you can indeed hear me, perhaps?
Yeah, an acknowledgement in the chat box. Here.
Okay, good stuff. Thanks very much. Well, listen, everybody, it's always a pleasure to be working with the folks at the International Securities Exchange. Especially, I want to thank everyone for joining in this afternoon. It's been a pretty interesting couple of weeks in the markets, and we've been extremely busy. Navigating our way through what's been a game, quite a little roller ride. Not only that, but of course it's summertime as well, and I find that a lot of folks just tend to try to enjoy their outdoor time rather than sitting in computers. So it's great to see everybody on board. Now today, what I want to focus on is a little bit on understanding key technical for FX options strategy selection. And as always, what we're going to take a look at some very relevant charts here as they pertain to many of the FX options pairs that are available through the ISE. Just to enforce, of course, that the information is for educational purposes only, and make sure that you really understand the risks associated with trading options before you go in and start clicking on the buttons to trade the contracts. A couple of very important characteristics of the FX options that I think everybody needs to be aware of. One of the most important characteristics is the fact that they are accessed through any standard options broker. So if you already have an account with a broker, it allows you to trade, you know, the typical equity options contracts that you may be utilizing. Understand that you can also access these ISX options as well. And why I think that's so powerful is, you know, particularly under, you know, the current market environment, and it doesn't just pertain to this market environment, obviously. There's a lot of talk about the currencies and what they're doing to one another and how they're influencing the markets and how they're being influenced, you know, by the state of the economies of their individual countries. Now, the traditional way to obviously access those particular opportunities would be through trading the FX market, but you know, many people are apprehensive about doing so. Many people don't understand how the spot market works and are not trading with a broker that allows them access to that. So why I think that these FX are so powerful is that, number one, you can already access them through any standard brokerage. Number two, they actually allow you to trade the strategies that we know and love and apply to our equity options sessions, and they allow us to do so with a limited and identified exposure. Now, the a couple of other characteristics. First of all, they are cash settled in U.S. dollars. The shares that we're looking at today are what are referred to as the note guard, or I don't want to use the word imaginary, but no underlying security that is deliverable with these option contracts. In other words, they are what, as I mentioned, are referred to as being cash. So if you buy a call option, let's say on the CDD at 88 strike, and ultimately the CDD pair forward to 102, well then the difference in the strike price and the settlement rate is in fact what would be settled into your account at the end of the expiration month. Now recognize, of course, that you can buy these options at any time throughout their life cycle, but ultimately they are what as European style exercise. And the reason why they're European style exercise is one of the reasons is that there is no underlying security to take possession of. If I sell an EUI call option because I believe that that call option is going to expire, if it's to get on the wrong side of it, I can't be forced to deliver anything. So in other words, my choice as the option writer to hold through until to see how things play out. Now, the IFC did a nominal job at making these providing a very diversified collection of FX saw trade, and you can see based on the chart that I'm sharing below that there are a number of the major pairs available. Now, what we will focus on and what I'll focus on today is the look, you know, the U.S. dollar versus the Australian dollar, or the AUX, the BPX, the U.S. versus the British pound. We'll look, of course, at the dollar, Canadian dollar, the CDD, the EUI, and the YU. Those are the typical ones that we affect the beach on. But again, depending on what your outlook is, depending on what your views are, that bank has been making some very interesting moves over the last little bit. So I'm going to consider taking a look at that particular pair as well. Now, nonetheless, the focus on making our trading decisions and determining what are the most effective strategies to implement come from an analysis of the pair values through a price chart, or I'll refer to it as a pair value chart. And you may be typically used to looking at a stock chart, if you will, and identifying the ebb and flow of a particular price of the price action in a particular stock. Well, we're going to do the same here, but it's going to be based on the ebb and flow of a particular pair value. But one of the things that I always want to reinforce, and judging by the names online here, I recognize many of them. You've probably heard this before, but the main consideration is that there is no holy grail trading technique. So despite the emails that you see coming through on a day-to-day basis promising, you know, this exceptional edge in the market, this perfect tool that you can use to trade the markets with high accuracy, recognize that there is no holy grail trading technique. There are tools to put the laws of probability in our favor and to help us navigate the markets more effectively. But at the end of the day, we have to rely on our own risk management and capital allocation principles in order to be successful. So again, technical analysis is a tool to be used in combination with those sound risk management principles. Our objectives are to identify trends and to identify support and resistance levels. Now, these really simplifies the whole principle, the whole concept behind technical analysis. But really, what we're using these price charts for are to identify a trend that's changing so we can lock in profits, or we can establish a strategic advantage of that change in trend. This goes for looking for support and resistance, and you'll see as we move forward in today's session, I'm going to show you how we can use support and resistance for identifying targets and particular levels for options, FX options writing strategies. So these simple concepts, these two concepts here that I'm referring to, really provide the foundation for decisions that we're going to make moving forward, looking at these pair value charts. Now the question becomes, how does technical analysis interrelate with FX options? Well, we recognize that in the options world, we can take two different sides of the position. So we can be an options FX options buyer, we can be an FX options seller, or in fact, we can be both at the same time. The important consideration is that no matter what strategy we think we want to implement, we cannot fully make the decision properly without establishing a directional bias. And this is done by, of course, identifying a trend. So we don't know whether it's appropriate to buy calls on the CDD or puts on the EUI or calls on the YUK unless we have a good inclination as to what direction that particular pair value is heading in. So that's really the first and most basic start to utilizing technical analysis for strategy selection, is identifying a directional bias. Now the next is determining a strategic entry point for an option purchase. Now, ultimately, we understand that FX options are affected by the passage of time, no different than an equity option affected by the passage of time. So ultimately, we have to realize that if we're going to an options buyer, if we're looking to buy a call option or buy a put option, the element of timing has to be something that we take into consideration. So by looking at a price chart and determining a particular entry point, it saves us from jumping in too early, perhaps wasting some time. And of course, we know time is money. But ultimately, leading and waiting and waiting for a particular move to take place, where we could have been patient, wait for that strategic entry point to manifest. Wait for the pair value to break beyond that, below or above, and then take action. So it becomes an element of timing as well. Now, resistance we use for establishing targets and exits for trade management, as well as for price selection. So when we talk about the idea of strategy selection, what we want to do is we want to tap into that, of course, the idea of selecting the most appropriate strike for our objectives as well. Like, we can actually determine might be a more appropriate strike price based on the volatility that we're viewing within the price chart, within the pair value chart that we're looking at. In other words, If we're looking at a pair that is relatively slow moving and has been within the range for a particular period of time, then we may choose an at-the-moon contract as part of our strategy versus something that is further out of the... And finally, if we're looking at potentially establishing a debit spread, which we'll talk a little bit about as well as we move forward, then we can identify key support and resistance levels where we think it to write the associated option contract in order to, sufficient enough upside, but at the same time, identify levels or certain enough downside if we're buying, doing a put debit spread to give us enough room to profit, but at the same time, recognize the key support and resistance levels whereby the pair may not, in fact, trade beyond and game trade that as we move forward as well. As FX options writer, of course, we can establish a directional bias by defining a trend. So in other words, if we're looking at a pair value that is trading to the upside, ultimately, we may want to consider selling put options because that as a pair increases in value to the upside, ultimately, the puts that we've written will expire worthless. And if we're considering writing call options, we want to do so to a pair that appears to be trending down. Now, that in mind, we can also look at these key support and resistance levels, areas where we would consider actually writing the options. So in other words, if we see a resistance level that has been in place for quite some time, well, then ultimately we may consider selling call options above that level because the pair value has shown historically that it does not may be on that level, which means call options are likely to expire that beyond that level. I mean, conversely, if we look at support levels at a level that has been established and respected for quite some time, we may consider to put options below that level, ultimately looking at those put options expiring as the pair value does not look to drop below that level. Also, the idea of proper strike prices for credit spreads, as well as iron condors, which I'll illustrate the strategies as we move forward as well. More or less just making sure you're not writing option contracts at levels whereby the high probability that we may find ourselves on the wrong side of it. So the more effectively we can identify these key support resistance levels, the better the probabilities in our favor. Now, Mike just has a reminder when buying calls are expensive, which is an example, will creating spreads make the overall cost of the option much less than simply buying calls or puts only absolutely. That was one of the points that I wanted to reference actually as we move forward. This is an ideal market right now. Creating debit spreads, because ultimately, as the buyer of a call or the buyer of a put option, depending on what our direction of bias is, we are subjected to paying for that increase in implied volatility. That's essentially the increase in premium that a market maker builds in for taking on a risk outside of the trade. But understand that in the options world and in the FX options world that we're referencing, we can create these debit spreads. And what it does is, while I'm the buyer of volatility on one side, I'm the seller of volatility on the other side, and it ultimately lowers of the position, which any of you that are somewhat seasoned options traders will recognize that Vega reflects the implied volatility of the option contract. So you are 100% right, Mike, in the sense that if you want to opt the cost of an expensive option contract, a very powerful way to do so is by implementing a spread. If you want to be the seller of very expensive option contracts, particularly in this market environment where there's a lot of uncertainty, then credit spread, which I'll talk about in a few moments, give you the ability to collect that option premium, but ultimately by purchasing that call option or that additional put option, your income is lessened, but your risk is identified. So some great points to consider there, particularly in this market environment. The other concern as we move forward is pattern identification for iron condors. And let's talk strategy in a little bit. But iron condors are essentially two credit spreads combined. We got a call credit spread on the upside. We got a put spread on the downside. And what we're really looking for is we're looking for a particular value to be range bound. Well, how do we know if it's range bound unless you take a look at the chart? And I'll show you an example of that here in a few moments. The idea is that if we can identify a key resistance level, if we can identify a key level, and those levels have been very well respected for an extended period of time, and ultimately, what we can do is we can look to implement these strategies. Andrew just asked me a question, what trade would I put on based on tomorrow's open? You know, and unfortunately, you're not really here to make any sort of recommendation. As we move forward through the charts here, you'll take a look at some ideas that consider based on, I'm sorry about that, Andrew. I wish I could help in that regard. But you'll get a couple of ideas that we might want to consider as we move forward throughout the rest of the trading week. Patricia's got a question. How do we find support and resistance levels during bubble markets like today? Well, I'm going to show you a price chart. In fact, I had to take pictures yesterday of the charts, but ultimately we more or less some significant range-bound activity in the bigger picture. But ultimately, Patricia, what you need to do is to look at not just today's trading activity, but you need to look at the trading activity over an extended period of time, you know, like a couple of weeks or a couple of months, helps us identify these key support and resistance levels. If you wanted to be short-term about it, well, you just have to drop your charts down to a shorter time frame, even shorter still. But we're gonna look at some charts, and I'm gonna clarify all of that for you in a moment. So let's first consider the idea of trend identification, and this is really the bare bones, most simplest approach to utilizing a chart. It's just the simple idea of identifying a trend, and a trend is simply the direction that the market is going. And we understand that a market never moves in a straight line, you know, unless you're the S&P over the last couple of weeks, which up until yesterday was in fact moving in a straight line, down, that is. But nonetheless, what we want to look for is what is happening with the price action over an extended period of time, and how what we refer to as the peaks and troughs are lining up in terms of establishing that trend. Now, the great thing about understanding the principles behind the trend identification is recognizing the fact that we can trade uptrend using options, we can trade a downtrend using options, can trade sideways trend utilizing options, which is a very unique characteristic not found in other asset class that's tradable. So in other words, in stocks, unique movement up or down. In currencies, in movement up or down. In futures, unique movement up or down. But options world, we can actually take advantage of sideways trends that allow us to implement strategies such as the iron condor or other various options writing strategies. So simple rules of thumb, and this really is extremely simple, but you'd be amazed at how often people overlook this. An uptrend will make higher highs and higher lows. It's as simple as that. So ultimately, if an uptrend is to continue and we are to be confident in that, then we need to see that uptrend continue to break the new highs or new highs within the time frame that we're looking at. And ultimately, each time that it pulls back, we want, obviously, the lows to be higher than the previous lows. A downtrend, completely opposite, is going to make lower lows, lower highs, and lower lows. What we do is we use the various peaks and troughs, so the points on the highs and the points on the lows, to draw our trend line. So here, for example, the EUY, it's the U.S. dollar versus the euro. And as I said, literally taken yesterday, but realistically, and what's very interesting is despite all the volatility in the equity markets, the U.S. dollar versus the euro has really been quite range-bound and indecisive for time now. But if I were just to pop a simple trend line in place here, I could use all of these points, and I'll just use my little identification tool. I could start down here, and I could touch one of those points, and I can recognize that as long as the pair value remains above that trend line, well, then ultimately we have an uptrend in place. Now, does that mean that uptrend is going to last extended period of time in it, and now it's the ultimate time to get in and go long? That's not what I'm suggesting. There are other variables that I've got to consider, but what we have to look at ultimately is that the first sign in a change of direction is a break of the trend line. Or if we started to see the EUI drop down and in fact start breaking below that trend line, that would be a signal to suggest to us to wait a second. It looks like this particular pair value may be lining up for an extended move to the downside, in which case I can be prepared to perhaps take advantage of some sort of a bearish strategy. With that in mind, we can take a look at the SF, which is the U.S. dollar versus the Swiss franc, and I don't need to draw a trend line in here for you to be able to identify what direction that's been going, but ultimately you can see by, in fact, identifying these various, what I would as pivot points, that the trend in force is in fact to the good side. So at this stage, really for this bigger picture trend to actually give us some signs that it was changing, we would need to see a reversal and a break back beyond that. Just to give you a little bit of insight, guys, what happens is as the market moves away from the longer-term trend line, and ideally you guys can see that additional trend line that I drew in there, and just bear with me while I give this other line here. But ultimately, as we see the pair move away from the trend line, we can use these shorter term levels to establish another trend line, and then ultimately we can say, okay, well, if we start to break above that short term trend line, well, then maybe we can create a target, use this bigger picture trend line as a target for perhaps going long or buying some call options down here. So that's one simple way that we can utilize trend lines. This is in fact a process that's referred to as fanning. So what we would do is, as a particular pair value or whatever security you're looking at runs a bigger picture trend, we would just simply fan the trend lines out each time that we saw a break above that trend line, and then we could start looking at some short-term trades all the way back into these further trend lines. So previous bigger picture trend lines are used as resistance. Okay, so that's one way that we can, as I said, look at utilizing trend lines.
Thank you for listening to our podcast. To find more podcasts on options, stocks, alternative markets, and market data, please visit www.ise.com/podcasts.